Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Okay. So the topic of my presentation, or you can say interaction, is very basic fundamental physics we are using in interpretation of evidences.
Sir,
And
we need this as a full mode so that we can read all
yes, it is in full mode, sir, I think.
the. No, sir,
I
it's
guess.
not coming as a full mode. It's coming as a palette format. Just click on the third icon. Yes, this one.
It is coming. There is some transmission, you can say. So again, I start interpretation of evidences using fundamental physics. So yesterday we have attended Ansari ma'am sessions, and she has completed and cover all the basic concepts of physics division, where we are working and which fields we are working for. But those she has not covered the practical aspects and the physical evidences we are doing. So I will try to cover two or three topics, and I also relate the forensic physics with engineering. So please be with us. So whenever I think about physics, the engineering comes in my mind. Why I say it's engineering? Because whenever the physical phenomena is present, there must be some mechanical, electrical, or you can say physical and chemical changes will be there. So these changes make the criteria of field forensic physics and engineering in advanced format. So I will try to cover these basic topics: what is forensic physics and engineering, how we can transmit from physics to engineering, and what are the cases we are working in the field of forensic physics where the engineering can also be a part of that. Like building construction material, we examine, and this is the part of civil engineering. Electrocution we do, and electrical and electronic engineer can help in us. Road accident analysis we do. So there is some mechanical engineers, automobile engineer, or you can add on like mechatronics is there. The causes of and origin of fire, there are chemical and physical analysts are always required, and the case of explosion, physics and chemistry is required. So because it's a very vast subject to discuss on, I will discuss only two topics here: building construction material analysis and road accident analysis. So when we come and cover with the engineering in the forensic science, first of all, what we have in our mind, we have always two things in our mind. Always have a balance between the evidences, and always have a balance between the knowledge. With the knowledge and evidences, always have a microscopic view of an expert. If you don't have that much of expertise, do not work on that, and learn, study and study, that make you an expert. So whenever you found a senior in the field, you will have sometimes say, oh, ye to PhD nahi hai, CR, like that. Some people like say like that, but I say those are having the experience of the field are always an expert. They do not need any degree, because when they work in the field, they have the vast experience of the practical aspects and practical problems. And those who have worked in the practical problems always have a great knowledge, and those people are always our, you can say, a book themselves and Bible themselves. They teach us, they give a guide to the points and to the aspect of crime scenes. And physics always require balance between science and knowledge and experience, and the microscopic aspects of your view. It comes with experience only. So when we think about criminalistics and forensics, or you can say forensic science or physical evidences, there must be a simple concept that the scientific methods to recognize, collect, identify and comparison of all type of physical evidences is the part of criminalistics. If we are able to identify and compare these evidences, either it is biological, physical, chemical, or whatever it is, but if you are able to identify and compare, if you are identify and match, if you are identified, recognized and compare, then these evidences are always the part of physical evidence, and this will help to make a justice to the victim family or victims himself or herself. So, as I told you that the forensic physics and engineering come in my mind always when I start, because whenever I start, because I was a teacher in engineering college, so I always apply my engineering mind also in the physics division. So the forensic physics used the concept of mechanical, chemical, civil and electrical physics as a tool of reconstruction of crime scenes, determining their causes. The major component involves in traffic accident, major causes involves in driver injuries, major causes involved in all type of artifacts, like you say, is there a failure in the mechanical or any chemical aspect of the accident, or whenever the building collapse, whenever the bridge collapse, there is a lacuna in the building material, there may be some lacuna in the civil construction pattern. So these are the deformity and structure deteriorating can also be analyzed by the forensic expert. Now we can say the DNA experts are there, the biological experts are there, the toxicologist experts are there, but the forensic person, physics and engineering persons are always having a great aspect and great value in the forensics. So what is the forensic physics? That is very simple or very basic concept. I always define that whatever you can see without a body and without a victim's body, victim's fluid, whatever you found, that is physical evidence.
Thank you, sir.
So if you see, I'm just going backward. The criminalistic I covered. I'm sorry that I got covered. So, sir, now you can see the slide of what is forensic physics?
Yes, sir. Visible, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So, I am sorry, all the participants. I don't know why it is happening with me today. First, the voice problem. Second, the slides problem. So, the investigation of any physical material other than body is the part of physics evidence. And that physical evidence are always analyzed in three manners. First, you can say comparison with the standards. Second, you say known and unknown. Third, you can say the question and the control. So in the ballistic division, in physics division, and in document division, we require those physical evidences to compare, to control, or to examine with the question. Whenever we found those other than the body or other than a living being is come in the category of physical sciences. So when I start my forensic, I started forensic in 2008. Before that, I don't have much idea about that forensics. But when I started, I use my physics, I use my forensics, I use my engineering, whatever I teach and wherever I found, I apply my mind to sort out the cases. And by luck and by virtue of God, I have been appointed as a crime scene investigator in the Rajasthan FSL for 9 years. And for that experience, I correlate my physics with these cases. So everywhere we go, everywhere we find, there is a collapse in a building, there is a design anomaly, you will found the forensic investigation of an engineer are always required. When we go on a building collapse there, we always call the civil engineer, we always call the electrical engineer, but the forensic view they don't have, and we have that forensic view. This forensic view provides us the separation, or you can say collection of the evidences. On those evidences are always a great value for the justice. Second, when we see the forensic physics reach at the scene of crime and reach at the evidence reach to the laboratory, there is a you can say correlation between the crime scene and the exhibits sent to the laboratory. Always have a standard query regarding to that, is this particular physical material belongs to that particular material or not. In this query, when the building is collapsed, the question is not like that. The question is always that, is this material having the standards or not? So these standards and those standards they provide by the manufacturing company or by the engineering firm that is constructing the particular site is always required. In Rajasthan, we have PWD and they have G18 form. And this is always for the building design. So that is required. Sometimes the insurance company always call the forensic persons, but we are not able to support them because we are liable to the forensic and police only, or for the investigation only. So when we go for civil engineering, when we go for the components, when we go for the particular material, when we go for the structures, when we go for the accidental or intentional failure of a building, there is always three things, our law, whether the civil or the criminal concept behind this case. So when we reach at the scene of crime where the building collapses, we have to collect a lot of things. We have to collect the bars, we have to collect the beams, we have to collect the sample, or you can say cement mortar material, at least 3 to 5 kg, so that we can separate out the ratio, we can separate out the samples and the brick structure. The structure and the building pattern design is always required to analyze. Second, many cases require the engineering challenges, like sometimes we don't have that much of knowledge regarding to the building. For that, we must have a very basic concept of civil engineering. And I'm going to explain you very 5 or 6 slides. You will find this concept of that. So whenever the building construction is failure, you found there must be some standard reason. So what are the reasons? First, the building failure occurs when the building loses its ability to perform its intended, means the designs. Hence, the building failure can be categorized into two broad ways. First, the physical, means the structure based analysis. Second, the performance failure, means the material they used may have some limitations, or the building have very older constructions, or you can say, which means the reduction of function below an establishment of established acceptable limits. Means we have 20 story building and we do not use the column with that particular material of iron, particular material of cement mortar, then the building may collapse. The performance failure is coming in that category. And physical characteristics means sometimes we don't have that particular strength to the building. So these are the main structure failure in the civil engineering: shear failure, bending or flexural failure, compression failure, tensile failure, foundation failure, and buckling. So I will explain these 4 or 5 slides next. So whenever we see the shear failure, that is occurs when the load on the building component exceeds to bond between the molecules of the material used in the strength of the connection between one member and another member. Shear failure mostly occurs at the joints between columns, beams, and solid walls and floor slabs. If you can see the upper photograph, means the shifting in the joints make this type of failure. And this type of failure, if you see a long building, you will find cracks in the walls. This is the shear failure. Second, the bending and flexural failure. Flexural failure, this occurs near the midsection of a vertical component on columns or walls or horizontal component of beams. It occurs due to loading that induced a moment that greater than the internal moment capacity of the material. Means if you see a bridge, and bridge have a capacity to load of 2 ton or 20 ton, and we apply their 80 ton or 100 ton, then there may be some, you can say, concrete failure, or you can say some sudden break is there. That is called flexural failure. Third is the compression failure. It is due to that if the building material or the gravity of the center shifted, the yielding, the crack almost immediately, it cannot be covered at all. So failure occurs near midsection of the members. This type of failure occurs stocky members. Fourth one is the tensile failure. This occurs due to the force applied on it. Means the concrete and the member crack almost immediately, while in a steel, the member elongated and become before snap. The failure near the midsection. Always you will find there will be a section in the columns, and these columns have some space, and due to that space, the material of iron, the rods they have used, have shifted from that particular center position. The fifth type of the foundation failure, that is in India, we found a lot of there due to global failure, due to differential settlement, due to sliding failure, due to bearing capacity, due to soil liquefaction, due to earthquake and rotation failure. It is in India, the foundation failure is a big problem, because I will show my case. The foundation is due to soil liquefaction or due to earthquake. We do not use the foundation as defined with the structure size, with the column size, with the building size. We don't use this in India. So in the village area, still it is being followed and the happening in till now. And last is the buckling. This type of failure occurs in the slim members, means the very, you can say, when a slab of required of 9 to 20 inches and we built it about 4 to 5 inches, then there is a shift in the perpendicular beam, and this perpendicular beam will shift it from its location. This type of structure, the failure is called buckling. So how we are, the forensic persons, reach at the scene of crime and analyze these things, we are not capable to do this. We have a civil engineer, we have an electrical engineer with us. But when we found the cracks in these buildings, like you can see this type, we can say, this type, we can say, the photograph itself teaches the concept of failure, the reason of failure. If you study, a lot of failures are there. Two types of failure always there, sometime man-made, sometime natural causes. Man-made and natural causes, man-made are due to the most stress associated with the material, are the consequence of human blunders. Means you can say the builder, the thekedars, the you can say the contractors, they change their material as per the norms, and they change their structure as per the norms. Then the failure due to the man-made. And the natural failure, we know the earthquake, we know that the building collapse due to high rainfall. Sometimes it is, you can say, due to high wind flows. So it is happening in both the manners, man-made and natural causes. When we study about some building collapse, this is news published in DNA in Mumbai, where you can say September 21 to Feb 15, there are a lot of buildings collapse due to property prices and rent in Mumbai among the highest Asia. Many citizens are forced to live in old and dilapidated properties in land scale. So all in the old Mumbai, the buildings are collapsed due to substandard materials, inadequate supervision of constructing multi-story structures, and the incident have highlighted shoddy constructions and violation of building codes amid burgeoning demands and housing in many parts of India, endemic corruptions. In India, if you see PHED, PWD, and these departments always say that there is some corruption. But whenever the building designed to construct to design in the government department or in any private sector, that is always follow some rules and laws. And all the rules and regulations, if they follow, there is no collapse in the building. This is an example of collapse of building where the human error was observed. The Konkona building collapse, weak column, strong beams, reason for disaster. This was the news in January 2014. This, you can see the photographs, the Konkona building collapse, weak columns. The column they have built are not age adequate to make a building of, you can say, 25 story or 20 story. And the grade they used, the cement concrete, was not as per the defined format. So that have a gap in the building material and the building collapsed. These are the photo I have taken from net. The more photograph of that particular building, Konkona building. You can see the shear failure. The columns have shifted from their locations, this particular. And these are not the part of forensic person. We are the person who are going to analyze this particular sample. We are not going to analyze why this is. This is being calculated and analyzed by the civil engineer, but the person who is visiting the scene of crime, but the person who is analyzing the lab will have a view regarding to the failures and reasons of the failure. Then the material, what material should we collect is a part of that. So sometime in India, you have always, you will found there is a tree outside their houses. So large tree growing vicinity of the building causes damage in the type of soil conditions. If the soil is shrinkable, clay cracking is severe. So all over the older houses in India and in the villages, you will find some cracks in the buildings due to the outside house outside trees. These are now I explain my two cases. In this case, there were 24 persons were killed and 28 were injured due to a wall fall in a marriage hall. And there was a marriage party was going on, and due to heavy rain, what happens? The all the persons who is getting the dinner at the marriage party take the shelter behind the wall, and due to heavy rain, the wall collapses. And all the persons, those are taking the shelter of the wall, are under the wall. Why this wall collapse? When we go at the scene of crime, I visited the scene of crime and I analyzed the material also in the lab. So when we reach at the scene of crime, what we found a height of the wall was 20 feet, but there are only two long columns are there. And other than the length of the wall was about 70 feet. So on the two columns, they have built 70 feet long. They have built 70 feet long wall with two columns only. That's why the column become loosey. Second, the foundation they have used was very low. They should use foundation at least 8 feet as per the civil engineer. But we found that the depth of the foundation was only 3 feet. Third, the material and cement mortar sent to the laboratory for analysis was not found as per the norms of that particular area. So these are the man-made collapse reason. Or when we analyze in the laboratory all the material, we found that the reason of the analysis or the reason of that particular collapse was due to heavy rain, and the material they used was not as adequate is required that for the particular marriage garden. This is the another case. As I told you, in India, the circle, I am myself here, so I just circle it. You can see there is a collapse in a building. The one room is still there, and the another room is collapsed. And we have been called, and this was the house of a Hindu. And the person told that the Muslim nearby me have blasted my house, and we have been tortured by them, and we died, and my wife died. So when we reach at the scene of crime, what I found, this is the body of that particular lady. When we reach at the scene of crime, we found that we just remove all the debris from the space, and we found the most important point. You can see this. The foundation become so loosey, and due to this foundation, the buildings collapse. And why it is happen? It is happen because they use the room as a bathroom in the corner. And this bathroom, they use the kacha area of that room, and this water comes in the foundation area of this particular house, and this foundation become loosey, and that's why the building collapse. And on the basis of our report, the case was closed. Otherwise, it was in the case of blast and murder. So now I come to my second topic of this session. I took my pardon that if they allow, I will take, Ranjit sir, if you allow, I will take it in 15 minutes because my session, I think it is completing now, but I need 10, 15 minutes more.
Yes, sir.
If you allow, sir.
Yes, sir. Please.
Sir, thank you, sir. So whenever we think about accident reconstruction, you see, found yourself that I am a crime scene investigator or I am a forensic person. So always take five things in your mind. Whenever we see a vehicle, whenever see an single vehicle or two vehicle or hit and run case or spot, always take the photograph of the vehicle from all directions. All direction means to say front, rear, left and right. Sometimes we are not able to observe all the points at the scene of crime, or due to chaos, due to law and order. But the photographs tell such a lot of things. So take the photograph, draw the scene of crime, measure the distances. Interview of witnesses is not our part, but listen them. Take some points of the witnesses. Look at the vehicle documents. Means if this any theft is there or not. And otherwise, the conditions, that road conditions, the weather conditions, the nearby area, light conditions on the road. These are the most important part of investigation when we are reaching at the scene of crime related to accidents. But nowadays it become a practice to reconstruct the scene of crime. So whenever we reach at a scene of crime, there are always, if the two vehicles are there, you will find pre-impact and post-impact effect of on the road. Means pre-impact means that first vehicle and second vehicle may collide each other. Before that, there may be some skid mark. After the point of impact, means where they collide, the debris you will find at the location where the collision occur. After that, if the both vehicles have speed, then there will be a yaw mark. There will be some, you can say, post impact skid mark. And when we analyzing this pre and post conditions, if the both the vehicles are there, we can prove each and everything. Other than in India, we don't find both the vehicles at the time in the scene of occurrence. We found generally one vehicle. Hit and run case we found. Sometime we found only vehicle like motorcycle. Sometime we found only the pedestrian. So whenever you reach at the scene of crime, always try to track out the skid marks, always track out the yaw mark, always track out the debris where you found. On the basis of these three points, we can calculate the position of impact, or you can say point of impact and point of rest of the vehicles. And on the basis of that, we can calculate the initial velocity and final velocity of the vehicles. So these are the yaw marks. This is the photograph I have taken from a book. So as I told you, my topic is the basic physics. So we can calculate the coefficient of friction on the basis of the speed of the vehicle, the distance of the skid mark, and the friction coefficient. Like every surface have its own friction, and the roughness of the system, roughness of the surface is called as a friction of coefficient, the coefficient of friction. So when I want to determine the coefficient of friction, it's very simple. We have four tire vehicle, like left front, left rear, right front and right rear. We have the value of skid marks. Calculate all the skid marks, their length, take their average, multiply and square root of 330, and you will find the value of the coefficient. If your vehicle is traveling with the 30 mile per hour, if your vehicle is speed with different, then calculate like that. So the minimum and the maximum possibility of the coefficient of friction can be calculated at the spot only. The law of moment of conservation is most important part when you are starting to investigate a road accident, because we always say that if there a collision is there, there must be momentum must be conserved. But when the collision is not in the directions, not with the same speed, then the law of conservation will not be followed. So the first law we know that, the second law we know that, I'm just skipping this. And you can see this one. When there are, I saw two vehicles are there, red and brown, coming towards each other with the same speed and with the mass is different. It means 200 kg and 2000 kg and 1000 kg. If they collide and attach to each other, then the velocity, the momentum, and the you can say the overall result, the momentum you will find in the way towards the heavier vehicle, then that will be calculated on the basis of P equals to M into V. That is a very basic. But in the practical aspects, if we go and we found this type of skid marks and we don't have the vehicle, even though we are able to calculate the minimum traveling speed, site of incident, evidence and lack of evidence and friction of the road, we can calculate on the basis of the skid mark only. And how we can calculate this basis of skid mark? There are eight type of skid marks. So the skid marks are having eight type of characteristics. When you found the straight skid marks, means front and rear tire are on the same track, then you will find that speed of the vehicle is very high. Straight offset skid mark means there is a bubbling in the rear tires, and you will find this type of. Third, you will see ABC anti-lock braking system skid marks. You will found some skip between the particular distance, or you can say periodic brake system you will find. Other than if you have a very heavy vehicle with long tail, or you can say with the trailers and small brakes we have, then there will be an standard braking system is there. And the skid marks, or you can say the braking marks, will found of the rear tire only. The gap, the longer brakes always have a long gap and pumping brakes on the skid mark. And the last one is the impact skid mark. This impact skid mark after collision we will find, but sometimes we say this is the yaw mark also. So when we go the skid marks, we can calculate the initial velocity, we can calculate the final velocity, we can calculate the distances on the basis of skid mark only. So how we can calculate it? There are standard formulas. You can see these are the formulas. These are in our 10th and 11th class, we read the Newton's law, Newton's first, second and third law on the basis of velocity, acceleration and time. Velocity, acceleration, distance and time, we correlate them and we can calculate all the initial and final velocity, whatever we have, we can calculate on the basis of that. And some tools and softwares also available to calculate these. And this is the standard formula. When the vehicles collide, before collision and after collision, we calculate the angle, we calculate the velocities, we calculate the W is for stands for here momentum. So if you see V1 cos theta 1 plus V2 cos theta 2 minus V2 cos theta 2 means the pre-collision angle and post-collision angle. Theta 1 is the pre-collision angle and theta 2 is the post-collision angle. And the days indicate the first vehicle and second vehicle. So if we calculate, we are able to calculate these parameters, we can analyzing and we can able to analyzing the possible momentum of vehicles. And I read it only in the literature. I never do this one because I never found two vehicles at the spot in India. And these are the possible collisions at the scene of occurrence. And all the, when the vehicles are there, police not called us. We have been called other last two points, other and unknown. If there is any other vehicle is there, we have been called. Is there any unknown reasons are there? We have been called. Otherwise, all the 8 meters, head-on collision, right-on collision, left and right collisions, rear and front collisions, these are all the police investigating agency done their own. We are called for other and unknown only. And these are the books I always refer to the forensic persons, those are working in the field of forensic science, forensic physics. If they required, any one of them required this book, please mail me. My mail address is there. I will provide you the soft copy of these three books. And these three books are very, very useful for the investigating persons, those are working in the field of forensic science, working in the field of reconstruction of accidents, or you can say some people now, computer engineers and mechatronics engineers, are working on the reconstruction of accidents by calculating some programs, then they can use these basic books for them. When we think about Indian conditions, why India, how much accidents are occur in India, and if you see the statistics, there are 23,000 per year Rajasthan people are died due to accident. And if you see the Indian statistics, it comes about 2 to 3 lakh, and the 2 to 3 lakh persons are not died due to corona in last year, but due to accidents we are dying like that. And what are the region in India? First, animal. Second, weather. Third, light. Fourth, road surface condition. Fifth, contributing circumstances like prior case, brake failure, vehicle failure. These things are there. And last, the traffic control. These six are the most fundamental regions in India. And we are not, still the Indian peoples are not aware of these things. We are losing our lives more than corona in accidents. These are the parameters. If you see, there are 100 parameters. When we reach at the scene of crime, we should observe these 100 parameters. And these 100 parameters always provide a lot of things like about dead body, about vehicle, about driver distress, about resistance, about hazardous actions, about airbags, about condition of vehicle, sequences of events, collision, before collision, what type of injuries, everything. If you cover these 100 points, or if you write down these 100 points at the scene of occurrence, you will find the result of your analysis. So this is a case. Last year, we have visited with our deputy crime scenes and me. We have visited this crime scene, and we have calculated the vehicle speed. And on the basis of our report, you can see the 100 kilometer raftar se luxury car ka pedal yo koronda. We have calculated the speed, and it comes about 108 kilometer per hour, as per the skid mark on the wall due to the collision. And that was, I don't remember, the Audi Q6 was the model of that vehicle, and the vehicle was driven by a lady. In the next slide, you will see the photograph. This lady was driving the car, and this is the original position of that vehicle. And when they collide, this boy shifted due to collision. This boy shifted from here to here. He become itself a projectile, and about 70 to 75 feet he thrown with the vehicle speed, and his leg was totally crushed. One side leg was totally crushed with this particular location. This particular location, his one leg was totally crushed, and the dead body was shifted to a building about 70 feet away from the road. Due to the speed and due to the skid mark, we are able to calculate the speed of the vehicle. Reconstruction process, which I always suggest to the forensic community. And whenever we go to reconstruct a scene of crime, it is either suicide, homicide, murder, whatever is there, we have 5 questions in our mind: what, where, when, how, and why. If we are able to calculate these, or you can say answer these 5 questions, then we can reconstruct the scene of crime. Either it belongs to suicide, homicide, murder, or accident. And what we do, we just analyze the investigative object, what the police, what the investigating agency required from the forensic person. Second, collection the background of the information, means whatever the FIR, whatever the PMR, whatever the possible documents we can collect. Pre-visit of the scene of crime, or pre-visit the site. Formation of our investigation plan, means what we need to the investigate to execute the reconstruction. Formulate our initial failure hypothesis, means we always, if someone asks it is a murder, then we start like it should be a suicide. If someone asks it is a suicide, then we start like it might be a murder. And that the formulated initial failure hypothesis always gives us the reasoning to sort out, or you can say, null value of that particular hypothesis. Comprehensive document study we have to do before reconstructing the site. Investigating, reconstruction, and sample collection, the physical analysis, fast check laboratory testing are the part of that reconstruction. If we are able to last the 4 points, 1, 2, and 3, and 4, this means formulation of a failure hypothesis, document study, site investigation means reconstruction, and physics analysis or fast check laboratory testing. If we are able to correlate these 4 points, we can say we are on the final conclusion and we release our report. Otherwise, we go our revision on the investigating plan and revise it, and again follow the same process whenever or till we are not able to find or reach to the final conclusion. We are not the magicians to always reach at the final conclusion, but we try our best to reach out at the conclusion. So thank you very much, and thank you very much, Ranjit sir, for giving me 10-15 minutes extra. Due to my technical issues. Thank you very much, sir.